get a mic or a mic in the hair. That's source only. Shout out to the editors there. Yeah, I'm all grown, so much better with math. I need a spread in the Forbes, taking the Benjamin bath. Yeah, I'm serving this track like Steffi Graf. Yeah, Roger Federer, there's no competitor.
Urban Tennis, episode 48. Serena versus everybody. Welcome back, everyone, to the Urban Tennis Podcast. I'm your host, joined by my co-host.
How do you do?
Very well. We are recording this on the evening of August 31st, Monday, day one of the Open. What a day it's been. Tons of upsets. We just saw Serena win via retirement. So despite the circumstances, she'll be happy with that. Currently, Nadal is up against Borna Koric. He's got to be happy with that. That's a tricky first-round matchup. But we got a lot to cover here in this U.S. Open Primer podcast. We're going to talk about the media coverage. Obviously, Serena had a lot of it going in. Talking about the chance of a calendar slam. We're going to evaluate that, kind of set the tone of what the tone was coming into this slam today. We're going to talk about Roger Federer, who was dominant in Cincinnati, introduced some new tactics, and should he be considered the guy to be here in Flushing once again? We'll talk about Marin Cilic. Yes, we're going to talk about Marin Cilic, even though nobody else is, the defending U.S. Open champ. And I'm going to end off with talking about our favorite tennis pop-ups. We'll explain what that means later on. Plus, challenges, games, and much more. So if you're ready, let's get started with episode 48.
Two games open. Taking up.
With Serena Williams on the verge of history, many traditional and some new media forces have spent hours trying to capture the importance of Serena's opportunity. So, how do you think this narrative is forming right now, and how this achievement could be viewed in the coming weeks?
Well,
potential achievement.
I think there's two real paths that are forming here. One is a lot of coverage of putting Serena in the context of women in general this year in sport. You know, along with the likes of Ronda Rousey, Katie Ledecky, the U.S. swimmer, and how this has been a renaissance for women's sport. The Women's World Cup, obviously, Carly Lloyd and that team. And then the other is just the importance and the resurgence of Serena Williams and Steffi Graf. I don't think I've read that a lot recently, but there's been interesting topics in the build-up, really comparing the two, who are very different players and different, had played in different eras, but in many ways you can compare them, because even though Serena is very, you can consider a very prominent figure, she does live and she can kind of become isolated from the world around her and can live, you know, within her team, and that's how kind of Steffi was the entire stretch of her career. So I don't know what you want to tackle first. Let's talk about, how about Serena with the context of this is like the summer of women, or the year of women in sport. Obviously, I think she should be leading that, and that's where sometimes I feel, you know, maybe we cover tennis, but it's an affront to her that you put Ronda Rousey with her and the achievements that Ronda Rousey's had against Serena Williams. Any thoughts on that? Do you think that's a fair thing that Serena is the headliner in a year of women's sport?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, granted, we are biased covering tennis, of course, but even if you try to separate the facts from anything else, Serena Williams is probably the biggest thing in sport. Okay, it is the biggest thing in sport this year, right? And you can make the argument that going for this Grand Slam is the biggest thing this decade in sport. You can conceivably make that argument, and I'm not taking anything away from Ronda Rousey. But you also have to recognize that she's more like in the pioneering stages of a sport, and she'll, like, maybe 10, 20 years from now, she'll be looked upon as, okay, if it wasn't for Ronda Rousey, our sport wouldn't be here. But Serena Williams, the sport is kind of already there.
Right.
And then she's at the age of 34, going for a Grand Slam, which is completely, completely rewriting the book, even in this new era of tennis where older players are more mature winners. 34 is still 34 years old, and she's been playing since she was 16 at a very high level.
And I think what sets this apart in terms of the coverage that she's received is the fact that her presence or her achievements kind of stretch beyond the traditional markets. That's what we said. How are new kind of sources covering it? We're seeing a lot of entertainment thing sites cover it. Obviously, there's a part of her personal life that is associated with it, but Serena Williams is part of that culture. She is, you know, she's able to walk on stage with Taylor Swift and nobody blinks an eye because she's at that stage. It's reached so many realms in our society right now, and obviously the Williams sisters are probably the only ones in tennis, at least on American scale, that will ever do that again, I'm thinking. So that's so important. And like you said, at 34 doing this, sure, sometimes you have to tie her in with the women's sport, but this is an achievement that stands even above that. And you kind of saw in this week that some approach it that way, some try to clump her together. But I guess that's what you get with me. Sometimes you get various sources covering. So you're never going to get a uniform message. How about the more interesting things about the Serena Steffi compare? Anything that kind of stuck out with you? Anything you remembered that you didn't know, or anything that you were enlightened about looking at those two players?
Yeah, I think you made a really good comparison before, talking about how on the surface you may think these players are almost kind of polar opposites. Like, you see Serena out there, you see her media personality, she's like, she's gone out there, done a lot of things.
Right.
But then Serena on the court is all business. And if she didn't have that time to take those breaks in tennis, I don't think she'd still be playing at the age of 34.
Right.
Like, if she played straight, like, without taking any opportunity to do anything else, I think she would have retired a lot earlier. And maybe she would have made a comeback, maybe not.
Yeah.
So I think each player approaches it differently. But at the end of the day, you can't deny that Serena Williams keeps her focus on the sport, just like Steffi Graf did.
And I think the coverage was largely positive. I don't think any of them were trying to put them, you know, head to head, even though it was, you know, the numbers, you could speak that for themselves. But it was the acknowledgement that both lived in unique times, you know, Steffi with the Monica Seles rivalry, and then the rivalry that wasn't after her unfortunate stabbing, and then Serena Williams and her ability or her career path that took her off the court for a long time, now the lack of rivals. So I think it was very positive for both. I think this is without it. I think if she does achieve the calendar slam, that's when we'll have the affirmations. Here, it was mostly acknowledging both players. I think they'll have the affirmations then that, yes, Serena, in the minds of most, is better. Now, we're not going to debate that here because I think that's a lengthy debate and, you know, it doesn't really fit in here, but I think that's something that's going to be written. What do you think, if the achievement does happen, how do you think this will even get bigger or more significant? Do you, like, is there a chance that this becomes a bigger thing than it already is? Or is that something we don't know?
I think it kind of has to become a bigger thing than it already is because it will actually happen.
Right.
Because I think a lot of people who maybe even inside the sports sphere may not even consider this a thing yet until it actually happens. Because then the Grand Slam is actually a Grand Slam.
And I could see even the social ramifications of this. So, you know, there's the temperament of society still in the U.S. I could see it being a definite statement for a lot of social causes that are happening. So I can definitely see if it does happen, it could be used as something that kind of moves the quotient of what society is doing forward, at least to some part. Okay, before that happens, obviously, she's got to play matches. She won easily today. She's got six more to do, realistically. A lot of seeds in her top half have gone. Maria Sharapova, injury, didn't start. Anna Ivanovic is out. Karolina Pliskova is out. Carla Suarez Navarro is out. A lot of the challenge. Sloane Stephens.
Yeah, Sloane Stephens is probably the biggest loss.
A potential third round opponent. So there's not much, it looks like, in the way. But tell me some players you're keeping an eye on as possibilities to challenge Serena Williams.
Well, the obvious easy answer is Belinda Bencic.
Yeah.
Because
somebody she would face in the quarterfinals.
Yes.
Yeah.
So obviously, only 18 years old, has her win against Serena this year at the Rogers Cup in Toronto. One of her, probably one of her favorite WTA premiers. So, and you could tell that it went three. It looked like Serena was in that match. She wasn't going down with injury. But at the same time, she's only 18.
Right.
So it works at one end that Serena hasn't become acclimated to her game yet or knows exactly what to expect from her.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, there's still a lot of growth that she has to make in her own game.
Yeah.
So it's a tall order to ask, no matter where you are at your game, to expect you to beat Serena Williams twice in a year.
Benches is obviously the big one. Everybody saw what she did in Toronto, and then, you know, it's going to be a big task. Not many people do beat Serena twice in 1 year. Another person, if she figures it out, she hasn't looked right in a long time. Madison Keys has the pace to match Serena, possible fourth round opponent. Her sister has the serve, obviously, to match. We don't know if she has the ability to execute that over three sets against Serena. That's a possible quarterfinal. On the other side is where Serena, I think, got a little lucky in this draw. Players that can groove and beat her are on that side, and they can only face her in the finals. I'm looking at Petra Kvitova, Sam Stosur, Victoria Azarenka. So, you know, like they say, there's not many until it happens you think it can take out Serena.
Yeah, and then Serena in a final is a very dangerous thing to face.
Right, yeah, so it looks like the path is clear through the quarters, and then once Serena gets to that final weekend, she's nearly unbeatable. But like we said, we have a lot of tennis to play. We'll check back in on Serena later on, see where she is, and see if her calendar slam is still on path. Let's move on to the men's draw and talk about Roger Federer, who only played one U.S. Open tune-up this year in Cincinnati, and he showed his mastery once again. But he put a little wrinkle in it this time, showing off some returns that caught the tennis world's eyes. Basically, he kind of anticipates the player's second serve, runs in, hits it nearly near the service box, and basically half-volleys it, shortens the time for the returner and the server, and basically dictates the point when he's not on serve. Definitely a nice wrinkle, but is it sustainable? I think that's where we got to bring the discussion. He used it a couple times, used it against Djokovic too in the final. No, let's take Federer out of it. Federer obviously 34. He's going to do different things and not do this. Could anybody potentially do this over the course of a tournament or the course of a season? Is that tactic, you know, timing the second serve, such a difficult task already, and then kind of like shortening the time to hit it, sustainable as a tactic?
Well, probably not, because eventually, if a player does that more than one match, more than maybe like two, three matches at most, then the server is going to say, okay, I'm going to serve completely different to this guy every single time. Because these are still professional tennis players, and if they need to, they'll go back and say, okay, I'm going to face this Roger Federer who runs up at me. I'm going to change it up completely, and I'm going to serve to the other side of the baseline.
Right, yeah. Yeah, I think it's more of a wrinkle than a tactic that happens. Obviously, and players don't have the confidence that Roger Federer does. We've seen over the years, obviously, he can behave and move on the court more so than any other player we've ever seen, potentially. So it's something that kind of seems unique to a player like Roger Federer. Yeah, like I agree, I don't think it's sustainable. But let's talk about what he did in Cincinnati. Not just the return that caught the headlines. Once again, he served excellent. Wasn't broken. Something we talked about at Wimbledon, obviously he was exceptional against Murray in the semis, but then didn't bring it against Djokovic necessarily in the finals. Djokovic was okay. Murray has been good. But is Federer now the guy to beat, or is that issue of seven matches, five sets, still something that you cannot put him entirely as the favorite?
That is,
at this stage in his career.
Yeah, because I think a big discussion about that is Federer too good too early now?
Right.
Like, can he sustain this through a Grand Slam where you're playing five sets? Even if you win in straight sets, it's still three sets. So he wins his first three, maybe four matches,
yeah,
and he wins them straight, that's still a lot more mileage than winning the going to the final.
I don't even think that's the issue. Like, the management and of it. I think it's essentially match for match. I think Federer could play straight sets, easy matches, but in a five-set incubator match, you just don't know what you can get at all times. There's going to be a little letdown, and I think somebody can get him in five. But I think in terms of quality, he has the best quality right now. More than Djokovic, more than Murray. It's just, can he put it together, and can he get lucky enough that he'd love to not face a Novak Djokovic in the finals? Say he faces a Raonic, a Cilic. Maybe that's something that works to his benefit, and he gets that in his, you know, luckier. He's on the bottom half of the draw. A match that a lot of people are going to look forward to tomorrow night, Tuesday night, is the number 3 seed Andy Murray facing Nick Kyrgios, obviously in the headlines of late. Talk about that match. Obviously not the best match for Murray. You never want to start a tournament with a playing player of that quality. Kind of what your feeling is, and then will we kind of get the litmus test of where Nick Kyrgios stands in the tennis world? Because New York crowds can eat somebody alive. So it's going to be a match late at night on Ash. Not late at night. It'll be a night match on Ash. Could we kind of get an idea of where the crowd kind of, say Kyrgios goes up a set, and he kind of starts entertaining them, will they turn back in his favor?
I don't think so. I think when you're talking about the North American sports atmosphere, they love their heroes, they love their villains.
Right.
They leave their decorum to the side a little bit. And I think if Kyrgios would have to really work his way throughout the entire tournament like that, not just one match.
Right.
Because, we're talking about New York. I'm not saying everyone there is going to be exactly like a Yankee fan, but then, hey, they'll still go after A-Rod. Yeah. So
I still think he's got the type of tennis, despite the headlines and all the things around him, that he can win a crowd over. And I think if he really starts playing well against Murray, wins a set, pumps him up, I think he can kind of neutralize the effect that a pro-Murray, pro-obviously controversy crowd can do. What he has to do against Murray, he's got to serve lights out. His serve has got to be almost 95 to 100% tomorrow. And then he's got to take chances. Like, Kyrgios is not a guy who goes and rallies long. He's got to take chances on the return game. For Murray, consistency. You know you can wear him down. If you need to play four, it's not ideal in a first set, but you know you have the legs behind you to do it. And obviously, Kyrgios' head, I don't care what he says, That's got to affect him, what has happened to him the last 3 weeks. So I don't think he's in an ideal state, but that'll be something we're going to pay attention to, obviously, in the bottom half of the draw that starts Tuesday. But let's talk about the top half of the draw and our defending champion.
Well, our defending champion, it could be a trivia question 10 years from now. Let's be honest, but we are going to give him the time of day.
Yeah.
And let's be honest. Even though Keeney Shikori was the one who disappointed today, being a 4 seed and he lost today in the first round, not much is still being expected of Marin Cilic as he tries to defend his US Open title. Partly as himself to blame, because between the US last year's US Open and this year's US Open, the only thing I remember him doing was a Letterman top 10. So
yeah, he hasn't done much. He made the semis in Washington. Otherwise, he's definitely not lived up to a U.S. Open champion status. He's going to lose a lot of points here. I don't think he's been necessarily unhealthy either. He's just not played well.
Yeah, it definitely hasn't taken that bump that Wawrinka did after winning his Grand Slam, where he became like a mainstay in the top 10. Or even say Cilic, we'll even downgrade this. Cilic's not even a mainstay in the top 15, top 20. It seems like he doesn't have a... He hasn't shown in the season that he could stay there.
Even though he has that talent. And like you said, Kei Nishikori out. That section is wide open now. David Ferrer, who's had injury problems this entire summer, and lost a set today.
And doesn't like the hard courts, really.
Doesn't like the hard courts. You know, it's hard not to see if Cilic is even 75% of his form for last year. He should make the semifinals. But what are some more reasonable expectations for him this year? Like, what does he have to do not to totally disappoint? Like, hey, remember when Marin Cilic won the U.S. Open? What does he need to do to kind of, like, save face, almost?
It's kind of difficult, but then I think ideally, like, have that matchup with Federer. Do you know, I think what happened in the semis at the earliest, which I know is a far away.
Finals. Like, yeah. So,
okay, or maybe
Djokovic in the semis.
Yeah, maybe not Roger Federer per se, but yeah. Like a top player, and to take them like five sets, show that yes, I can play good against the top guys.
So you're essentially saying he shouldn't bow out early.
Yeah, because
like, play to his seeding at least, or play to his ability as a hardcourt champion.
Yeah, because even leading up to US Open last season, we saw like on the hardcourt swing in the US Open series. He was playing really tough against all these top players.
Right.
So if he shows that he can do that, then it may like get his confidence back and start knocking off some of these lower ranked players that he should be beating. They should have been beating all year, really.
Yeah. Well, we'll see. He's got to earn his way back. The U.S. Open organizing committee put him on Armstrong today, so they didn't get the ash treatment as a defending champion. So he's got a lot to do in people's eyes. Someone who doesn't have a lot to do is Novak Djokovic, who makes the finals in essentially every tournament he plays, at least of the Masters and the Slams. Heavy favorite to make the final. Top half of the draw. Is there anybody you think can spoil his run? Obviously, Nishikori last year took him out. He's out. Nadal's there. Raonic, Ferrer, Cilic. Which one of those players, let's say outside Djokovic, which player, one of those four guys do you see showing the best here in New York?
It's tough because Djokovic can play so well against all those guys.
No, let's say no chance against Djokovic. Oh, okay. Of the other four guys I mentioned, the four other top 10 players.
Okay.
Who do you think is set up to play the best here in New York? I think it's Rafa Nadal. Personally, we didn't see him here last year. I know he looked tentative in Montreal and Cincinnati. Obviously, his peak is much higher than Raonic's, Ferrer's or Cilic's. I know they would face in the quarterfinals. I know we're probably not going to be close, but I think Nadal is suited to be the guy who impresses the most, even if he loses to Novak Djokovic.
Yeah, I could see that. The only thing is, like, has he shown enough, like, he did good on clay, but after a moment, but he's done, like, okay-ish. He's actually played just his seeding as a 6-8 seed on hard court. So, but then, as you can always say, like maybe once it shifts to a Grand Slam, maybe a player like Nadal, who usually doesn't look like he needs that extra motivation, could actually subconsciously get that extra motivation because of the Grand Slam and start moving up and takes a lot of easy early wins and put himself in a good position in the quarters.
Right. Obviously, this section has already been affected by Gael Monfils pulling out. Tsonga's there as a sleeper. Obviously, Djokovic will probably dominate the section, but once again, we'll see as we pay attention to both draws moving forward. Okay, in our media technology segment, pre-slams, a lot of sponsor commitments. I think in New York more than anything, maybe it's just the fact that it's a little stretched out more, the fact that there's not a Master Series event the week or 2 weeks before, 3 weeks before.
It's Winston-Salem.
There's a week break. But it seems like a lot of sponsor commitments. And obviously this one, the big one this year, I think the Nike guys brought out their top players. They set up a street court in the fashion district or the packing district. Some sort of district in New York City. They made it look good. Brought out some legends, brought out some of the young guns. Obviously, had the four big ones, Serena, Maria, Rafa, and Roger. And really created a nice, I'm going to coin it as a pop-up event, you know. It's a one-off, assembled in the morning, disassembled at night. But what do you think are key elements in making a good tennis sort of live promotional event? And we talked a bit about this last time when we talked about virtual reality, but what about in reality? What makes a good tennis live event, promotional live event?
I think, first of all, you need that spectacle. I think if you have those couple of star players, you need to have that little bit of extra oomph on it to show that there's something cool that these guys are doing.
Right.
So, like, there was a... It was kind of weird, but it was kind of cool. I remember one time there, like, it was like Nadal and Federer playing tennis on water or something. So,
yeah,
they would, like, bounce the ball back and forth. And it was cool for a second, but then you realized, yeah, they're just kind of volleying the ball back and forth.
Well, yeah, but then it's the photo op. They were able to get it. I know that Nadal and Federer, I think, have done a lot of this, and that's when, I don't know, we'll bring up some of our favorites, or they've had a match, a charity match, I think, when half the court is clay, half the court is grass.
Yeah.
So you need, I got an element that sets you apart. I think the setting is important. I think, you know, we took urban tennis because we feel that tennis can be played anywhere if you have concrete, if you have asphalt. So then setting it on an asphalt court amongst buildings kind of makes it stand out. You put the yellow taxis in representing New York City. It stands out. And I think, like you said, I know it's called hits and giggles. You know, players just fool around, hit volleys to each other, make some jokes. But in a sense, you need players with color in them. You know, somebody who can hold the fans' attention, hold the organization's attention, and the sponsor's attention for more than half an hour, if need be. We don't, obviously, we're not privy to all these events. I know the players have to do this a lot. But I think a cool setting, which we got here with the Nike people, and a player who has some sort of color, some sort of flair. You know, they don't have to, obviously tennis is a global game, so not everybody's going to be comfortable in English necessarily, but some sort of comfort, like, you know, Nadal has done enough where he has a personality in English, even though if his English isn't perfect. Any other kind of pop-ups that you've liked in the past, or any other elements that you think are critical for a tennis pop-up live event, promotional event?
Well, I think a good mix between younger, like, current players and past players.
Yeah.
I think that's always good. Then you get the, you can appeal to across generations, across an entire spectrum.
Right.
And then on top of that, you kind of just need that, like I said before, you need that extra, like,
oh, if you need the stage, and before U.S. Open's a great stage.
Yep.
I know every tournament tries to do it.
But then New York is New York. Obviously. I mean, everyone's in New York.
Exactly. So. Varying amounts of success, but I think it's always fun. I think they're always trying to do something different. You know, I saw Jeannie Bouchard, Grigor Dimitrov one in Acapulco once, where they took a helicopter to, like, an island, and, you know, there was a tennis court there. So, always a great locale, and always having some of the players promote. Okay, nearing the end of this pre-U.S., early U.S. Open podcast, not pre, early U.S. Open podcast.
Yeah, because we're watching U.S. Open right now.
Yeah, almost the end of day one. Nadal now up two sets, so it looks like he'll advance.
There's your live update on a podcast.
Okay, let's do some challenges. U.S. Open challenges. Want to kick it off?
Sure. I think my only challenge is kind of an unrealistic challenge, but I seriously don't want to see any comment, any tweet, any, like, Vine, any Snapchat mentioning Serena's body. I'm done with that. Seriously, let's just talk about her accomplishment on the court let's leave it there.
Yeah.
Okay? That's my challenge to, like, literally every single person in the world.
To me, it's like always that thing where you have a young child who picks up on one thing and they keeps making that same joke. You know, it's not a joke. It's a reality. Serena Williams is a confident person, however she looks, and she's very capable at doing what she does. She does it better than anybody else. So I agree. I think that's it's a bad joke, even if it's a joke. My challenge is to the U.S. Open. A lot of site changes. We've seen the superstructure of the roof. It looks really good. It looks like Ash is going to be louder because the acoustics are going to change and sound's going to reverberate. But you're changing grandstand next year. You're going to lose some of that charm of the U.S. Open. So that's what I'm challenging you to keep some of that charm. You know, don't make it too posh. I know the amenities are going to pick up on these side courts, but keep the atmospheres where they are. That's kind of what brings out the outer courts of tennis. It's the atmosphere. It's not the ability or the amenities you get on some of these smaller courts. It's the atmosphere. Hopefully you can keep that atmosphere where it is. Social media highlight of the week.
Social media highlight of the week is kind of social media, kind of not. But it was shared on social media. I'm always a big fan of Google Doodles. And to celebrate the first day of the US Open, Google had a doodle with a G playing an O.
Yeah.
And it was a very long rally. Like, I think somebody clocked it. It was 142 shots.
Wow. So it did end. I thought it just kept looping. Wow. Yeah. Okay. So if you have the patience, wait to the end of the 142 rally. I wonder what kind of point they use. There's overhead lobs, smashes. I wonder what point ended the rally.
An unforced error.
No. Always an unforced error.
No, I'm just making that up.
Thank you for listening. You can download the episode on SoundCloud at the Urban Tennis Network. You can listen to older episodes on YouTube, searching Urban Tennis Network. The blog is urbantennis.wordpress.com. Folks, it's the US Open. It's Serena versus everybody. It's episode 48. Enjoy. Tell them if they want it, they can come and get that. City, I just want less. See me, they sit with me, they ain't ready for that. Detroit versus everybody. Right off the rotten apple by the poison tree. All these females need to email to make noise, and nothing's changing a lot. He fuck with my authority, then he shells seashells, but not by the seashore. If he gang banging or not, as simple as the alphabet. He F with me, that G shell surely see. He definitely is bout it. It's retail fraud. He's weak, the honest gesture, the trigger finger round a diamond tester. We tail flaw with heat. The same soldier, it's me, myself, and I riding round, shooting my biopic in my autobiography. Range Rover, this ain't the squash beef steak. You thinking makeup, we thinking Lark Voorhees face.